appreciate you coming to and hear us play this evening. I'm Chris Van Hof. This is my colleague and partner in crime, Michael Seregow. And it's our first time ever in Columbus, Ohio. So it's really been great to be here. I got to meet a lot of you this morning in the master class and had a lovely lunch with Dr. Tanner. And we're just really happy to be playing this music for you all this evening. It's really a treat. The first piece that you just heard is by the great Colombian composer and jazz pianist Carolina Calvache. She's somebody who I am really happy to call at least an internet friend. We've actually never met in person. But I've played a couple of her pieces. This one, there's another really charming piece she wrote for Achilles Larmacopoulos in the Canadian Brass called Tromboncillo. And I even commissioned her to write a trombone duo for tenor and bass trombone called Transitions. That's a particularly lovely, very unique duo. You can hear a lot of Carolina's personality in that music, her jazz background, the usage, especially in the second half of that piece, of the pasillo, which is this Colombian traditional dance that kind of shifts between 3-4 and 6-8 time. We like playing that one. It's one that actually Michael and I have played for a couple of years now. Next on the program is a really major work for trombone and piano. It's by the composer Anthony Barfield. Some of you may have heard of him before. He's written a couple of really cool pieces for trombone choir, and a particularly stunning piece called Red Sky for trombone and wind ensemble. This piece he wrote in 2007 for his teacher at the time at Juilliard, Joe Alessi. And since then, Anthony has really stopped playing the trombone, but he does continue to compose, and he works in music production and recording and editing. A lot of that in kind of the popular music and hip-hop and R&B world. But he still composes. In fact, this weekend, the Toronto Symphony Orchestra is opening their concert with a piece of his, alongside Haydn, Mendelssohn, and Barfield, which is pretty cool, I think. So, very, very interesting composer. This piece, Meditations of Sound and Light, is just that. It's kind of some impressions of sound, air is the second movement, and light. The first movement is very, very sustained. Michael hardly ever lifts his foot off of the sustain pedal in the piano. It's very driven by kind of harmonic, long harmonic language and explorations of different chords. The second movement is really beautiful. He writes in the solo part to be played in a vocal manner, so he really is looking for just a beautiful, intimate singing sound. And the last one is just very zippy and dancey and very angular, but lots of fun. So this is Meditations of Sound and Light by Anthony Barfield.
Thank you. Thank you.
has feelings too. Let's see here. I think I'm going to take a quick pause and set up all of my stuff up here for the next piece, and then we'll introduce it, okay? So just bear with me. Give me 1 second. I have some constructing I have to do here. Stage is set. So, this next piece on the program is by the American composer Robert Suderburg. He wrote this piece in 1980 for, it was originally written for and performed by a very famous kind of modernist avant-garde trombone player named Stuart Dempster. Trombone players in their house, of which I think there are only maybe one who's not a trombone player. You should know who Stuart Dempster is, okay? He's an incredible, legendary player in our field. And in addition to that, he wrote this piece, Suderburg did, for his dad, who was a jazz trombone player as well. Suderburg was born in the 1930s, and he kind of eschewed a lot of the typical 20th century American classical music styles of like really, really super academic 12-tone serialism and slightly more audience-friendly things like minimalism, like what we hear from Steve Reich or John Adams. So he's a really interesting character, very unique compositional voice. And this piece, for us on the trombone, is one that draws a lot from jazz playing. And I think he does a really good job of capturing that. He's very specific about who he wants me, to sound like, and how to do it. So some of the players that he mentions in here are, of course, Stuart Dempster, but also Vic Dickinson, who's a famous trombone player, a member of the Duke Ellington band. You'll hear me do a little bit of angry plunger playing. That's supposed to be in the style of Vic Dickinson. Phil Wilson, legendary Northeast Boston-based jazz trombone player. There's kind of a special glissando that Phil Wilson did that I'm instructed to do. And lots of other very funny things. Now, this is my sense of humor, which is like, it's a place you don't always want to go. The dark reaches of my mind. It's a terrifying place sometimes. But this music kind of sums up what I think is funny. So the first movement is really pretty straight ahead. It's called Cry Man. And you'll hear me playing those words. The words are written over the notes that I have. So you'll really hear about halfway through where it says, really, it's Cry Man, like that. Then the second movement, it's been a long, long time, kind of morphs out of the first one. And that's when I turn my back to you all. And it's this really weird, like, opium-fueled fever dream of a Viennese waltz, if any of that means anything to you. So it's very, very weird, very smoky and covered and kind of from another world, almost. Very, yeah. But then there's these little snippets of, like, Christmas waltzes, and it's kind of funny. And then we morph back into the last movie, which is called Brother Devil. And this is very, very funny. And in fact, it's all centered around the punchline to a joke about a priest that Suderburg knew. He didn't know the priest, he knew the joke. Well, he didn't know the joke either. He only could remember the punchline. And he wrote the punchline into the trombone and the piano. And we like kind of shouted at each other, but not the actual words, because that's what we call weekend words, and we can't say the actual words of the punchline on stage. I'll tell you what it is afterwards if you really want to hear it. So, all I can say is, in the immortal words of Samuel Jackson in Jurassic Park, hold on to your butts, because this piece is kind of wacky and weird, but I think you'll enjoy the colors and sounds and humor and moods that Suderburg gets in this night set for trombone and piano. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's okay. We won't. We'll play Sue Library. Unless he's back. Sterling? Are you there? He's not. It's okay. No, that's okay. I shouldn't say when I'm playing just for trombone players. Last night we did a recital for not trombone players, just for the general public, up in Michigan. And I always try to play a standard work that we've played for a long time as trombonists. And the reason that the Šulek is on the program tonight is because Michael requested it, which trombone players, you might be aware of, that's highly unusual, because the piano part's very challenging. And usually they see that and they run away. And they're like, no, give me like a Baroque transcription or something. But he opted to do this. Which I'm just going to ask, this is very informal. Do you care if we play the duet right now?
Sure, let's do it.
Let's do it. We're going to play the duet right now. It's going to be great. Just like we planned. There are now 9 degrees of music on stage. So we're really doing it great. I'm sorry, I changed the program.
Oh, you're good.
So we're going to play the Šulek in a little bit, thanks to Michael. But right now, we're going to play this lovely duo. Now this is an idea, this idea of playing a duet when you visit a school that I got from my teacher in my master's, Mark Keller, a fine trombone player and teacher at the Eastman School of Music. And he would always do this when he goes somewhere, he'll play a duet with somebody. I just like it, it's fun to make music with other people that I haven't gotten to make music with before. This particular duet, I think you should know the story, what's going on, because it's from an opera, and that's always crucial. So here we have two ladies, okay? I am Lakmé, this is Malika, okay? And we are at the point in the story where we were both in love with the same young man. We don't, now, she doesn't know that, but I know that she likes him and he likes her. I like her, I like him, but he doesn't like me because he likes her. Does that make sense? Okay, that's opera, so let's get used to it. Here's the thing. I am, shall we say, in the autumn of my love life, whereas Malika is in the springtime, okay? So younger lady, apropos of a younger man, and I'm older than the young man. So during this duet, we're actually singing different texts. We're not singing the same text. Malika is just doing her thing and singing about how great it is to be in love and this guy's so great and he's gonna be my bae and all that. Do you still say that? Bae? Is that it? Did they do that? Okay, I don't know. I haven't dated since 2001, so it's been a minute. And I, on the other hand, am coming to the realization that, as I said, I am in the autumn of my life and I am coming to terms in a happy, kind of bittersweet way that no, I'm not going to be chasing after this young man. This is young love, these two, and they should be happy together forever. And so, on the one hand, it's joy and love, and on the other hand, it's kind of bittersweet, but it's just absolutely gorgeous music, either way you slice it. This very famous duet, usually for two sopranos, as you might expect, by the composer Léo Delibes from the opera Lakmé. This is the very famous Flower Duet.
Thank you.
study with this gentleman. What a very fine musician, incredible teacher, and just a great all-around guy. That's a rare combination in the music world, I can tell you. So you should all consider yourselves fortunate to study with Dr. Stjepan. Let's give him a round of applause. So as I was saying earlier, before I totally messed up the program and made him jump in early, Michael is the reason that we're playing the Šulek, and Michael is also one of the reasons, in addition to my students and some other my colleagues and facilities, of why I love to teach and work where I do at Ball State. He's an incredible pianist, and just like I was saying about your teacher, just a great guy and a great hang. And I'm especially gushing today because this is the fifth of five recitals that we started playing a week ago Tuesday. We started at our school at Ball State, and then on Thursday we were at the Cincinnati College Conservatory of Music. On Saturday, Western Michigan University, yesterday in Grand Rapids, Michigan, in the public recital, and tonight we're here. We're also gonna be kind of bringing this back out on the road to next semester, to Bowling Green State, up to Interlochen, University of Michigan, Michigan State. So we're taking this program out around this music we enjoy playing. But everything that I have to do with this gentleman is easy and enjoyable and fun, from driving, leaving at 5 a.m. to playing some of the hardest repertoire that a pianist may encounter. So Michael, huge thank you for all the work on this, and this is fun. I look forward to continuing to do it. Michael Seregow, everybody. So this piece I love. It's got handwriting from all three of my teachers from my bachelor's, master's, and undergrad on it. Bachelor's, master's, and doctorate, sorry. I've played it a bunch, and Michael's played it a bunch. We've listened to a bunch of recordings, and we now kind of have our version of it that we like to play. We do a couple things different, a couple things that might be familiar. So we hope you enjoy this piece. Thank you again to Sterling Tanner for this invitation. We'll have you up in Muncie shortly, for sure. And thank you all again for coming, for being a great crew in the master class earlier this morning, too. I appreciate it. So here's the Šulek Sonata, Vox Gabrieli. Thank you.
Thank you.